Welcome back, everyone. In today's lecture, we're going to focus on the different parties to crime. This means that we will be exploring the different roles of the main perpetrator and any accomplices who might be present. We will also discuss criminal liability for each of the individuals who actually take part in a crime, no matter what their role actually is. Let's get started. To begin with, we have to acknowledge that sometimes people commit their crimes by themselves. This is a very simple equation, and it's not very difficult to prosecute. If you are the only one suspect present, then you don't have, then, oh, okay. See, 8:30 is not my friend. All right, we'll just go again. To begin with, we have to acknowledge that sometimes people commit their crimes by themselves. This is a simple equation, and it's not very difficult to prosecute. If you only had one suspect, then you don't need to determine who knew the plan, who was involved in the conspiracy, and whether or not there were any supporting players present. But that doesn't always happen. We hear stories on the news about co-conspirators who are planning and carrying out crimes together all the time. They might not be very good plans, per se, but there are always stories about multiple people trying to accomplish some type of criminal activity together. So when more than one person is involved, we have to figure out the roles that they play. Are they physically present for the crime? Did they just help plan out the bank robbery ahead of time? Did they provide supplies for the main perpetrator to commit the burglary? Did they drive the getaway car? Dependent on the level of involvement that specific individuals are engaged in, they will fall into one of four main categories of involvement. We're going to go through these different categories in just a few minutes. Their level of involvement will also influence the way that they are being prosecuted. If I'm the main perpetrator, they will be prosecuted more harshly than if I was the getaway driver. I will be prosecuted more harshly if I was physically present for the crime, comparative to if I was only involved in the planning process. But sometimes it doesn't matter what my role is in regards to prosecution. We will speak more about vicarious liability later on in this lecture, but there are different criminal statutes that allow for equal prosecution of all co-conspirators, no matter their role in the crime. But before we explore liability issues further, we need to begin defining the roles of the individuals who are actually involved in a conspiracy. I always like to use the example of a bank robbery to better explain these different roles to you. So let's begin with principal in the first degree. This is our main perpetrator. Let's pretend for a minute that I'm about to have my house foreclosed on. In order to avoid that foreclosure, I need to come up with a plan very quickly to get some money, and I have to come up with that money quickly. Even though my job pays well, it doesn't really pay nearly enough, and it doesn't pay me quick enough either. Where am I going to find enough money in such a short amount of time to avoid foreclosure? Then I figure it out. The bank. The bank always has tons of money with the amount of deposits that they take in any given day. So I'm going to rob a bank. But then I think about how complicated that actually can be. So I actually need to come up with a plan to rob the bank and to rob it well. That's going to involve recruiting some friends to help me out. But this is where you all step in. So let's say again that I'm the main perpetrator or the principal in the first degree. But I can't do this all on my own, so I need to find some accomplices. What if my best friend would be willing to help, and she just so happens to be an expert safe cracker? Isn't it convenient that I have such good friends that can help me in a pinch? So let's say I approach my best friend, and I tell her my idea to rob the local bank. I tell her my plans, and she's all about it. She thinks that this is an excellent idea and is more than willing to help. You'll remember that from our last lecture, we have now formed a conspiracy. Once my friend actually agrees and we start to plan our robbery, she has now become the principal in the second degree. She's going to help me plan, and she even agrees to physically be there on the day of the robbery. By being physically present, she's equally liable to the crime in question, meaning that she would be charged with bank robbery with me. If she wasn't physically there, then she would not be charged as highly, meaning that she would be charged with conspiracy to commit the bank robbery. Finally, we have two more classifications of co-perpetrators. Let's say that even though my best friend and I are planning to rob this bank together, we've decided that we need more help. She suggests that we need ski masks and firearms and tools that are going to help us crack the safe if we can't convince the bank manager to open it for us once we're there. So where are we going to get all those things? Well, she just happens to know a guy who can get all of the necessary supplies for us. Once she asks him and he gives those supplies to her, he now has become an accessory before the fact. In order to meet this classification, you either have to help plan, provide supplies, or do something else that's going to help aid the principal actors before the crime actually takes place. It's not required that the accessory before the fact be physically or even constructively present like it is for principal in the second degree. Finally, we have to make sure that our tracks are covered once we actually commit the robbery. This means that we need someone to hide us from the police. I have another friend who has a couple of acres of land outside town where we can hide out. I asked my friend and they agree, so we're planning to hide out there once we successfully rob the bank. We didn't ask anybody to be a getaway driver this time because we think we can get out in time on our own. But my friend who owns the safe house has now become an accessory after the fact. I told them that I planned to hide there after the robbery and they have agreed. They are aware that I'm planning to do and they have agreed to keep the police off my trail if they happen to show up at the safe house. It's very important that this individual actually know that the crime has occurred in order for them to be charged. Let's say that I did try to secure a getaway driver, but I never actually told them about the crime that I was going to commit. I just asked for a ride home from the bank at a very specific time. If my friend agreed to do this without any knowledge of the robbery I just committed, then they would not be liable. They have to be aware of the crime to be liable. This is a very important point to remember. Modern classification only places individuals into two categories. First, we have accomplices who are our principal in the second degree and our accessory before the fact. And finally, accessories who are only our accessory after the fact. You should be aware of these classifications and categories and where everybody actually fits. So typically, we're going to charge defendants based on their individual actions and what they have done to participate in the crime. However, when people work together to commit crime, we are able to charge them for all things that happen within the course of a conspiracy. There's no individual identity anymore once the conspiracy has been struck. The concept of derivative liability actually erases the individual's identity. This means that anybody and everybody who was present for the crime are charged the exact same way, no matter what their role. Anyone who is involved in the crime but who wasn't physically present for its execution will be charged with conspiring to commit the crime. Additional charges may also be included depending on how involved the plan was and what exactly took place. What prosecutors have on their side is the ability to prosecute for just the simplest aid that is provided. If you provide an address to the bank, knowing that I'm about to go rob it, you are now implicated in that crime. Even the simplest act can fulfill the requirements for accomplice or accessory liability. However, again, you must be aware of what is going to happen. If I ask you for the address and just say that I don't know where the bank is, then you're just being helpful. Knowledge and intent are very important keys here. Simply being in the wrong place at the wrong time isn't enough anymore. So think back to that getaway driver scenario. If I ask you for a ride home from the bank, and you're outside in the car waiting for me to be finished with my bank business, you just think it's normal, regular, routine banking that I'm doing, and the police show up and they see you sitting there, then they're probably going to assume that you're the getaway driver. But if you're clueless as to what's going on, then they would have to find some evidence to show that you were aware ahead of time and that you agreed to your role. So this suggests that mere presence isn't enough anymore. But there is one exception to this rule. The only exception to the mere presence rule exists when there is a duty to intervene. This means that if you are present at a crime or present when someone is injured and you don't do anything to stop it, then you are now liable. But remember, we aren't talking about the Good Samaritan issues here. We're discussing only those who have a duty to intervene. So parents, those who assume care via contracts, doctors, teachers, those with some sort of legal responsibility, a spouse, employers, and anyone else who is supposed to be intervening because it's their job to do so. I keep discussing the importance of knowledge and intent in order for liability to kick in. There's a reason for that, and it's because it never used to be this way. In the case of United States v. Peone, a case that we saw in 1938, we saw a case where Mr. Peone was being prosecuted for mere knowledge but no intent of the crime. The defendant Peone possessed bills that he did not know were counterfeit. He sold the bills to another man named Regano, who then turned around and sold them to a third man named Dorsey. Mr. Dorsey was then arrested with the bills while trying to pass them out in Brooklyn. At the trial level, Peone was convicted as an accomplice to Dorsey's possession of the counterfeit bills. So, the last guy in line, Mr. Dorsey, did take possession of the counterfeit money, and he did try to spend it. But if you have no idea that Mr. Dorsey was going to go out and try and spend it, then are you responsible? That's the question that Mr. Peone raised. So in the end, yes, he did assist, but he did not intend to assist because he had no knowledge of what was about to happen to the money once he gave the bills to the second guy in the chain. The SCOTUS ultimately ruled in Mr. Peone's favor and reversed the original conviction. Looking at the federal code at the time, the statute stated that anyone who, quote, aids, abets, counsels, commands, induces, or procures the commission of a crime should be punished for it. However, the court read this language to require purpose and held that Peone had no purpose regarding the use of the counterfeit bills once he passed them on to Regano. Peone had no purpose regarding Dorsey's possession because Regano was free to do whatever he wanted with the bills. So now, federal statute and many state statutes have been changed in order to include purpose and intent. So, if you're going to be prosecuted as an accomplice or as an accessory, the DA has to prove that both assistance and intent to assist occurred. Further tied into accomplice liability is the idea of escalation and foreseeable consequences. Under the natural and probable consequences doctrine, you should be able to predict something that could potentially happen during the commission of another crime. So, for instance, if during our bank robbery we were to bring in firearms just in case we needed to use them to influence the people inside the bank to be more cooperative, so you might walk in there thinking that the only thing that's going to happen is the bank robbery. But let's say your partner ends up shooting and killing a resistant bank manager. Well, that's probably a foreseeable consequence of the initial robbery, and now we have a felony murder situation occurring. This really builds into derivative liability. If one guy does something, then everybody who's present is equally guilty of whatever is committed. I now want to spend a few more minutes discussing accessory after the fact, simply because there are multiple elements that are embedded within the definition. So, you can see that there are four elements on the screen here that discuss the role of the defendant. What do these key elements actually mean? First, there has to be a completed felony. This means that the crime has taken place, the perpetrators have not yet been caught, and the principal is trying to avoid capture. Next, I have to know that the completed felony took place. You told me, I saw it on the news, or I knew that it was happening ahead of time. In this instance, I could potentially be considered an accessory before and after the fact if I assisted you before the crime actually took place. Next, I must complete some sort of affirmative steps to actually help you out. This means I'm going to let you in my house to hide you, I tell the police that I don't know where you are, or I mislead them and tell them that you are somewhere else. I could drive the getaway car, I could stash the stolen money, or anything else that actually helps you stay free. And finally, there has to be intent. It's my intention to mislead the police. I know where you really are, and I don't want you getting caught, and it's not a mistake that I'm hindering their investigation. I am simply not just being a good friend driving you home, but I am intentionally trying to get you away from the police in the quickest way possible so that they don't know where you are. This classification structure allows the DA to prosecute defendants when they might not have been able to get them for the actual crime. If I'm not present for the bank robbery, then you can't charge me with that bank robbery. but you could still get me for assisting or planning or conspiring to commit that bank robbery. Because you are not present for the crime itself and took no part in its preparation, then you would not be charged with the crime. Instead, you would be charged with obstruction of justice afterwards if you helped hide the actual defendant who committed that bank robbery. I am now going to end the lecture today by discussing vicarious liability. Vicarious liability extends to responsibility rather than to overt action. This means that if your child does something and is still a minor, then you as the parent would be responsible for that action even if you weren't the one who actually did it. So for example, if you let your friend borrow your car and he ends up running a red light, the traffic camera catches your license plate and sends you the ticket to your house. You are still responsible for that ticket even if you weren't behind the wheel, since that's your car. That's vicarious liability in a nutshell. For example, when we talk about employers, they have to be responsible for the actions of all of their employees. If I am building faulty products that are harmful to people, and I'm the CEO of the company building those products, then I am directly responsible. I might not have been working on the assembly line, or I wasn't anywhere near the actual production of that faulty product, but if that's my company, then that's my responsibility. We've already discussed parental responsibility somewhat, but we haven't discussed social host laws. This is important to discuss because of the high frequency of this type of thing actually occurring. So many underage kids have parties after prom or at graduation, and they need a place to go drink. Normally, a parent gives permission for the child or for the kids to use their home, or maybe they're not even aware that this party is happening at their house. Either way, they're still responsible. If you have a party on my property and underage minors are drinking on that property and something happens, then I'm responsible. Let's say actually nothing happens beyond the underage drinking itself. I could be charged with that. But what if those young kids, one young kid, let's say, actually drinks way too much and gets alcohol poisoning and dies on my property? That's the worst case scenario, isn't it? I'd be just as responsible, especially if it happened on my land. This speaks to the responsibility that is present even if I did not directly have a hand in the crime that had occurred. To wrap up, in this lecture, we have explored the different types of accomplices and accessories that can be present during a crime. We identified their levels of involvement and responsibility, and even brought in legal precedent to show the progression of the liability laws. This lecture shows who is involved in different types of crimes. In the next lecture, we're actually going to start putting things together in the planning stages to show how these actions really occur. Meet me back here next time when we begin to discuss attempt, solicitation, and conspiracy.